Please give a big round of applause to Nicola.
Thank you, Tina, for the introduction. I'm actually very, very happy to be here. I'm actually not just happy to see you. I also have a flipper in my pocket. But and thank you for getting the joke. But that being said, by now, probably many of you already have heard of the Flipper Zero. But even if you don't, today I'm going to provide a sort of an overview of what it is and also what it is not, because there are a lot of misconceptions around it. Very quickly, absolutely who I am. My day job is about email security and deliverability. So I am an email expert, but that's how I pay my bills. But I was always interested in physical penetration testing, security in general. I've been playing with a lot of toys. I'm a huge geek and nerd, you know, whatever you want to call me. Since the early 90s, I was also into lockpicking, so all the kind of stuff. And I'm Italian, and within the Italian community, I launched a course on the ethical use of the Flipper Zero, and I'm also the administrator of all the Italian communities around it, Telegram, Discord, whatever you name it. Yeah, I'm the admin there. So I'm known even within the Flipper Zero community. But again, with the Flipper Zero, it's all started with the Kickstarter. In 2020, they launched this project about this device, toy, hacker tools, whatever. And they were hoping to get $60,000, you know. But within 8 minutes, they got there, raised all the money. And before everything ended, they actually ended with about $5 million. So that was insane. And I was one of the original bakers, and that's why I have a black one, but it's just for, you know, a vanity thing. But with a bigger budget, there were bigger challenges for them, but also they were able to put more stuff within it because they were like, we have more money to spend, your research, and all of that. Again, really, nobody was expecting that much popularity. And a lot of the effort was into getting certification to make it an actual legal device. This is an absolutely legal device almost everywhere. But popularity actually caused them some trouble. So entire countries like Brazil, Canada, even Israel, at different points in different ways, they kind of banned it. And even in different times, again, both Amazon and eBay banned it, is, you know, you cannot truly sell, and now you can somewhere. But anyway, if you don't have one, if you want one, just use the official sources. There's no point in going elsewhere nowadays. But it's true that especially at the beginning, the demand was so high that there were also scammers, people trying to sell this thing that's supposed to be like around 180 euros for even, you know, three times that. So there's a pet dolphin. It's just like a Tamagotchi. This is very nice. It's cool, I think, because there's a component of gamification within it. So there are a number of security gadgets included in the Flipper Zero, but actually you also have this mascot, this cute dolphin that the more you play with it, the more he's happy, it gains experience. So it's a cool thing. But behind that, there's a lot of tech. There are antennas for RFID, low frequency 125, high frequency 1356. There are IR infrared transceivers. There's a Bluetooth, USB, iButton. Oh, of course, the sub gigahertz antenna, blah, 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 blah. In other words, a lot of antenna. Okay, so there's all kinds of antennas in it. And again, look how small it is. So let's try to see a little bit better what it does. Okay, so RFID. So RFID in general is a sort of a technology that has many different types of technology, but in this case, I refer to the low frequency. So there are access cards that operate on the 125 kilohertz that, yeah, basically you can read them, store the information, and write it in a new card with the Flipper Zero in a matter of seconds, at least for many types of RFID 125, because they are very low security. But it can also emulate. So from the Flipper itself, you don't need a card. You can just put it on the reader and it will work. But it's cool because also animal microchips are RFID. So you can read your animal, your pet, microchip, but also if you find a dog, you can actually track down the owner, you know, and that's fantastic. And again, there are other challenges here because while my friend and I were researching this thing, we discovered that a lot of vets just put rewritable RFID on animals. So imagine there's a lot of things that you can do, bad things as well there, you know, kidnap an animal and just change his identity. Maybe it's just because I watched Ace Ventura too many times. But anyway, NFC is still an RFID actually technology, but with NFC we talk about a higher frequency that is 1356 megahertz, and it's way more secure and complex than the regular one, the 125 that I just spoke about. And there are different types of chips within this frequency, so it's again way more complex than what it looks like. But FlipperZero can read them, can write a new card as well, and can also emulate. But sometimes those NFC cards, again, additional layers of security. For example, sometimes you need a password to unlock whatever is in it, and you can retrieve the password from the reader itself. Fun fact, I am staying in an hotel here in Copenhagen. They are vulnerable to this thing. So last night I just came back, used my flipper to activate the elevator, enter the room just for fun, because it could do it, even if it's an NFC, but it's an NFC ultralight with password. Anyway, other times, you might want to, but you could actually crack the NFC by collecting nonces from the reader. So basically, it's not exactly what it is, but it's sort of sessions, tokens that you can use to infer and generate a key. But anyway, the FlipperZero is able to do those kind of attacks sometimes with the help of like the mobile phone or computer. But FlipperZero also has an infrared transceiver, as we said. So you can read any infrared remote you find and emulate it. And this is cool because not only you can truly control everything in your house with a single device, so it's truly a universal remote, but there are universal remotes already stuffed into the FlipperZero. So you can have a universal AC remote, etc. But you can also program your own. There are so many interesting uses for this. Like you can have super custom remote, but you can also discover that there are secret IR code in televisions and other devices that let you access to secret features. So it's cool. Once you know basically how that specific device is operating, you can just try all the potential buttons, even those that are not in the official remote, and you might find something that does maybe supposed for testing, for whatever. But that's cool. So there's a lot of stuff you can discover there. Now, sub-gigahertz is a big thing, I would say. And by sub-gigahertz, as you can imagine, we talk about frequencies that are under the gigahertz. So the reality is that the chip is the CC101 that actually operates between 300 megahertz and about 990 something megahertz. So it's still a stricter band, but in that band, there's so many things like barriers, garage doors, ring bells, even cars and sex toys. There's a lot of stuff. I told you I played with a lot of toys. I mean, not necessarily this, but you could. And there are, again, all kind of software and programs that you can run on your FlipperZero to truly play with other people's toys without them knowing. I mean, they will realize very soon. But the thing is, everything I'm saying to you, just keep in mind that these are technologies that are everywhere, and they have been around for years. That means that on top of those technologies, there were constructed different levels of security. So the FlipperZero can interact with all of this, but keep in mind, only on the lower end of the security. You know what I mean? There are applications within everything I'm saying that you really cannot do anything with the FlipperZero, because luckily we figure out a way to make those systems more secure. Like for example, with sub-gigahertz, a very basic concept, but it's very important, is the difference between fixed codes and rolling codes, okay? Fixed code is I capture your signal. It's like I capture your password. If I know your password, I can use it every time I want it, whenever I want it, etc. Rolling code is way more different. Well, first off, it's huge, so you can't even figure it out easily. You can brute force it that easily, but every time is different. So the modern cars and garage doors, by modern, I mean anything that was developed after like 96. So, actually usually tends to utilize rolling codes. So they are way more secure. It doesn't mean that they are perfect, but there are also manufacturers like Honda for every model until 2010 or 12 or so. They were using fixed codes. Everybody else in the world was using rolling codes. And there are on the web, not even the dark web, there are signals that you can use to open an Honda that was produced before that year. So it's, you know, that's the thing. One very cool thing is that you can pair your Flipper Zero to your phone, so you can have ideally potentially the Flipper Zero sitting in your pocket and control it casually from your phone. If I'm playing with this, I can grab some attention, but everybody's playing with this phone every time. We are addicted, so it shouldn't raise too many suspicions. So that's something actually very cool. Of course, it works with the sub-gigahertz, because sub-gigahertz doesn't require line of sight. With infrared, you cannot do that. iButton is a technology probably you are not too familiar with. Maybe some are, but it's another way. It's another kind of access, key access technology. It's very common in the East, Eastern Europe as well. Sometimes you can access building with it. In the Western world, I would say it's still used oftentimes for things like identifying themselves, like in supermarkets, the stuff. Sometimes they use this keys. Anyway, the Flipper Zero has a built-in iButton reader and writer and emulator, so you can do all of that. Again, if you want it, if you need it, you can do that as well. So that's also pretty cool. This thing has Bluetooth, and you can use it as a human interface device. So I didn't have the time to pair it to this laptop, but I could really run this presentation just by using my Flipper Zero and go, you know, back and forth, et cetera, et cetera. Again, nice to have just something that does everything in your pocket. You know, for somebody like me and many of you as well that attend or speak at conferences, it's still handy, you know? Now, the human interface device also opens to other concepts, to other things. Have you ever heard of the rubber ducky, right? Well, the whole point to the people that didn't hear about it, basically, we really like when you can connect a new keyboard, a new mouse to your laptop, right? It's so nice. You attach it, you can use it. That's a big vulnerability, because once you pose as an HID device, you can eject keystrokes. And the rubber ducky is one of those interesting toys that can type thousands of keys in a matter of seconds. So you can use it to load payloads in a victim machine, a target. And the Flipper Zero has this functionality built in. And there are many payloads already available on the web. And it's very easy to script, to be honest. The ducky script is very easy. So you could potentially just plug it to a victim device and with one click, you know, open a terminal and automatically do everything you want to do. You unplug it and you already exfiltrate data, et cetera, et cetera. And this is using USB. You can also do that over Bluetooth. So, but talking about USB, you can also use it as a universal second factor, as a passkey. I mean, I don't recommend to using it for that, because, you know, it's saved on the SD. The SD is not encrypted, so it's more of a proof of concept. But you can actually use it for multi-factor authentication. That's cool. Now, everything I said about the Flipper Zero right now are basically about the stock features. But it's an open source hardware and an open source software. So you can expand it. And once you start expanding it, the sky is almost the limit. It does 18 GPIO ports here. It means that you can attach whatever PCB you built or you found online or somebody is selling and do all kinds of stuff and make your Flipper interact with other devices. Turns out that a couple of brands of electronic safe are very vulnerable to a certain type of attack, where you can just basically put a couple of wires to it, because it's very easy to unscrew. That's by design. You need another way to access the thing. But anyway, you can just plug a couple of wires and say, please open the lock. And the safe is not that safe anymore. Unfortunately, I can't. Well, the safe can go faster, but yeah. Yeah, anyway, please okay to open safe. I mean, quite explanatory. It's plugged in there. Okay, open safe. Again, that works. Of course, the manufacturer are aware of this vulnerability for years, of course, and they don't care. That's so sad. A very common module is the Wi-Fi module that actually is in ESP32. You can build your own, but this is the specific one that Flipper Devices, the company, was selling to help developers to have a certain interface to help debugging things. But turns out that you can also flash the firmware of this board with whatever you want. So there are all kinds of malicious or firmware designed for malicious activities that give you the ability to do all kinds of attacks over Wi-Fi as well. A very popular one, I would say, nowadays is the evil portal. And evil portal means that you are able to create an hotspot. It's a true hotspot, but whatever you are serving there, it's not that true because you are posing this case as a Google free Wi-Fi hotspot. You are serving HTML with a login screen that looks like Google. And there are hundreds of all kinds of portals online already ready. You can just, you know, if you are at the airport, you can pretend to be one of the airlines or the airport itself. And anytime that somebody see, oh, a free Wi-Fi, I'm going to use it. Oh, I just have to put my credentials. That's fine. Those are stored in a TXT file within the Flipper Zero. So this thing is crazy, it's insane, but it's nothing new. Again, what I want to stress a little bit here is that it's nothing new. Evil portals have been around for years, but it's so handy to have it there. And again, you can have that in your backpack and control it from your phone as well. So this is kind of scary. And you can create your own portals, again, depending what you want to do. But creating an hotspot is nothing bad by itself. Every time I want to connect my computer using my phone hotspot, it's exactly the same thing. But it's different, of course, that I'm not posing as anybody else. So talking about firmware, there are many custom firmwares. The original firmware is nerfed by default, by definition, because it has to be a legal device everywhere. And especially with sub-gigahertz, for example, I mentioned that the range is, you know, 300 to 9 something, but we civilians, normal people, we are allowed to listen, to receive all of them, but we are not allowed to transmit all those. Radio is highly regulated. So the original firmware only allow the frequencies legal in the country you're in. And Europe is pretty much aligned. So it's a very tiny, tiny band. So the very first thing that custom firmwares fixed or changed was, let's remove the, you know, those restrictions. And the more common and known are nowadays are Unleashed, Rockmaster, Momentum. But they can do other stuff. They are constantly being updated because, of course, they keep the pace with the original firmware and add stuff on it. Again, mostly features that are a bit borderline, but also add protocols. So you are able to process and recognize more different types of signals. So it's quite cool. But of course, if you want to use the Flipper for potential illegal uses, you will probably need a custom firmware, but it doesn't mean that if you use a custom firmware, you're doing anything wrong by itself. In fact, some of these allow to turn back on the restriction about the frequencies. So that is, okay, I'm gonna operate in the legal, regular frequencies, but I still want the freedom that gives me this particular firmware. And sometimes it's also a UI change, or there's many things that are different. Anyway, and something I didn't mention earlier, Flipper Zero supports apps. And it's a play of words, of course, but Flipper Zero apps are called FAPs, F-A-P. F-A-A-P-S, FAPs, and you can find all kinds of apps. And so, yeah, you can do a lot of things, and there are things that you still cannot do. So it's just like a Swiss Army knife. It means that it sits on your pocket. It's very versatile. And the reality is that there are devices that do all of this stuff better than the Flipper itself, but there's no other device alone that can sit in your pocket and everything in that. So what I found out is that it's great for education and learning new technology. I learned so many things just by playing with that and teaching how to use it to other people that I think is gonna shape the next generation of cybersecurity experts. I truly believe that. Thank you.